scanning. And I think the country as a whole is also underprepared, and you want to look at where the greatest returns are, and you want to look at policy. So I'm going to take this opportunity to talk about basically one issue, which I think goes to the heart of any education institution, and that is the concept of acquisition. What does the university provide in terms of educational value? What does the business school provide in terms of education? Whether that's the recognition. In terms of whether the increase in additional income is really what people should use as a way of thinking about where to go, where to invest. Now, I want to sort of bring the argument back to why we're here. And I want to frame it in saying that our goal at IUB is to be the best university. We are very large, and that is an ambition that is fostered by the complete unstinting support of our universities. You know, all over the world, elite institutions basically have a very simple model. They take in the top 0.1% of superior graduates, they do very little with them, and at the end of the day, these students end up being fantastic graduates and they do very well. And that is certainly the model that has been true all throughout history. I'm reminded of the issues with this model. In a recent article of The Economist, every year The Economist puts out this top discourse, and I read it very accurately, because I want to see where my alma mater focused. And I'm glad to say, as every list in the last 20 years, Harvard and Western, my two alma mater, have done well. Harvard is number four. Chicago, for some reason, is always number one. Northwestern is my other alma mater. But the point that I wanted to focus on is when they constructed that list, one of the criteria that they look at is the increase in median salary from the from the time that the students got in to the time they graduated. The mandate they've given us is to be the best. It's not to be number three, number four, also ran. We realize that this is a very, very challenging mandate. And this, by the way, is also true for all our institutions. So since the discussion is with business school, our mandate is to make it the best business school in the country, initially, possibly, then school. And what we need from this August body, and I'm glad that that what we need to do is more than just showing up three times and having a nice patient. We actually need your help, and I'm saying this very bluntly. We need your help, we need your engagement, we need to know from you what we can do to make ourselves better. You are, and I'm doing that only in the corporate sector.
For our students and the future generation of this country, because we, in the trust, because it's not a business concern of ours, unfortunately some of the private universities in Bangladesh have given us a bad name. But I can vouch for each one of us, the management is here, the faculty is here, they know we do it for the love of the country. And we shall continue to strive and do this. We have now provided a platform, a springboard for all you ladies and gentlemen over here. You're all also the sons and daughters of the soil. Help us now to take this forward. Help us, assist us, industry collaboration. You're all successful in your various walks of life, and I'm sure each one of you must be thinking that there's something you can also continue to do in a philanthropic way for Bangladesh. And we have provided this opportunity, and we want you to work together with us to take it forward. And I look forward to the seminar that we're going to have, and I'm sure I'll go out wiser with new ideas. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And the most important reason is that for many, many decades, business schools all over the world were doing their business unchallenged, and they taught students whatever they thought is appropriate. And recently, very, very strong criticism has appeared all over the world, starting in the United States of America, that there is a big disconnect between what the business schools teach and what the industry, the government, various organizations, what they need. So in trying to overcome that gap, all the schools are turning to each industry, and turning to various organizations, and they're asking for their need. Now when it comes to asking for the need, there's always one danger. The danger is that we have more like this for decoration purposes. We take few pictures, we publish it, say yay, we need it. I recently, from the instruction of our honorable chairman POD, approached one of the leading universities in the Middle East and asked them if they would like to cooperate with us. And their response was, and this is exactly what we want for this board. We don't want you to come here, sit and have a photo of the session every so often. We actually want to hear from you. We want your input. At the same time, coming here, working with us, you are telling us what is it that our graduates should have for your demands. We hope to develop other kind of cooperation with you. Just recently, the board decided that the office of the Pro Vice Chancellor, that is my office, would be in charge of outreach and extension in continuing education. And in those three areas, I'm not going to go into detail because I'm running out of time, but in those areas, we are willing to cooperate with you, offer certain things to you, and learn from you.
We are going to next respond to parents and
from what I have seen that though the Bangladeshi intellect is quite high, culturally we are weak, humanly we are weak of making this the best in the country, in the region, in the world. I believe it's time that I could respond to some Bangladeshi universities and talk to this topic, so I'll go ahead and that way. Point that I want to make here is that teachers also need training. We have the teachers here. You need to actually go out here, have the opportunity when you are visiting anything in some part of the world, or spend some more time and go for focused training courses, which can bring back here and improve the abilities of your students. This is actually my great feeling. I think I'll rest here because of the positive time, the opportunity, as the chairman said, if I say anything, I'm going to let us.
Students need to come out graduating with these things that are at the tips of their skills to be competing. The workforce skill sets that the children need to, or the students need to hold on. And again, based on what from my experience, I would think that few of the traits that lead to a competitive mindset, the killer instinct, and the give up on giving up attitude, the resilience and persistence that you learn on the job, these are life skills that we need to be wiring our DNA. Second thing would be to have a very positive growth mindset. I think in our culture and in our country, we need to be thinking of leapfrogging with the very positive growth mindset. And these are things that, that when we interview, we look for.
And ensure that we also sustain growth along. That's what I'm glad I'm here, and as well as whatever contribution we make. Of course, Bangladesh probably has never arrived at a time that the opportunity is there and are willing to take it forward. For example, a bank is just not a big amount, it's like people, that's what people have. As I interact with the new recruitments, possibly new graduates coming in, some of the gaps that I see probably this type of connectivity with the university recruits. Elevator pitch or how to communicate the, sometimes you know I see these answers coming in, you know, elaborating anything but not giving the right points. Probably that's one area of development we can see that. As far as we are concerned from the banking side, when we recruit, we see that we are developing an area in the financial modeling and also deeply understanding. Let's say a finance graduate comes in. But probably, they still don't understand all the things that they should have understood in the universities. I think some of these areas Otherwise, we see talented individuals coming in as they are getting exposure to the internet, and there's no difference between a student in New York or a student in Bangladesh. How are they capitalizing their opportunities? That's all. I think I'll leave it at that. Maybe we'll have opportunity to do so.
And we have to get it from the parents' perspective, from the students' perspective, from the teachers' perspective, and from the user or the corporate's perspective. I think if we look, and from my little discussion with the students, it has become narrowed down to, I need my university degree to get a job. And I need the job to get a salary. If it becomes so narrowed down, then the role of, and you know, I know the students are looking at me, so just bear with me, this is a very dipstick sort of a thing, but I think that is what I want. If this is the situation, then you know, we have to look and ask ourselves that the parents are paying. Why are they paying? Do they just want to have the children a job and a salary? Then the job to be done is very clear. Alright? The students, why do they want to come to a university? Is it to absorb and learn, or again coming back to the salary? Is the teacher here to teach for a salary, or to teach for learning and thereby leading to some of these? And why the field? And I think we all recruit MIT. Because these people are going to help us solve the problem.
We have started recruiting for work. So our management trainees who we send out to London, most of them don't return. Because they are so good, they are grasping them and keeping them there. So I have no doubt about the talent potential in this country. There is all the great talent we have. Where we are probably slowly drifting away, and that's why I agree with my colleagues with all the issues, is we probably have a societal problem. The biggest challenge we find is we hire somebody very high potential, great results from the universities, and we send them out, and we were just talking about somewhere in Taiwan, for example. Okay, that's your first job. You have to go out there and make a good business result out of that place. Our students who come out of these universities, A, struggle to live out on day one. We have to provide immense amount of support and almost keep them afloat in that place for the first 3 months. We do that because we believe in their ability, we believe in their future potential, but they need a lot of support just surviving the society in the first 3 months. Which is an issue I think we need to understand how we actually integrate with the haves and have nots working together side by side. Because day one, you are actually ruling or running a big distribution house, which involves two government coalition. If you cannot connect with the people, it's not. You're building, you're investing for your future. The future that you've been working for 30, 40 years. And yes, I say 40 years because the job doesn't end after you retire these days. So how are we actually inculcating in them the long-term view, rather than just getting out of the university and landing on the university in any of their thesis usually. So that's one area. And the third area I would say is where I find we are struggling in the glass ceiling issue globally. When we send out our managers, they do very well up in the functional levels. And when it comes to the leadership passage, leading a function, leading a country, we struggle a little bit. We actually struggle compared to our neighbors. India, Pakistan, Indonesia, because of the confidence in our own abilities. Our people need to be very proud of being a Bangladeshi. They are always copying someone, following some other country, some other discipline and practices. The reason why I'm successful, why I actually came back as an undergraduate first time in Bangladesh, is because day one I've been doing exactly what I have said, being a proud Bangladeshi, always wanting to come back there. I don't want to settle anywhere else the next day. So this pride factor is very important for us to be. And if you are not proud of yourself, you'll never be successful and you'll never have that long-term vision and the purpose of life. It's not the next summer. That's what I'm actually facing. That's the issue that we need to focus on. We do not have any challenges in the current
think the curriculums are good. I agree with Kamranbhai also that yes, we can participate a lot. We just did, I'll just finish with this thing that we, for 13 years, we've been doing a program called Battle of Minds, where we bring in university students and for 2 months actually help them see what a professional life is. This year, we actually let them run 10 restaurants for 10 days. And the restaurant owners actually opened up their entire books and let them design a promotion, and they ran it for 10 days. First, I was very skeptical about the restaurant owners, why they would actually do that, because you're sharing very big secrets or your business strategies with these young boys and girls. When I saw the results, I understood why restaurant owners were very willing.
I've worked for a banking group for about 2.5 years, and the reams and reams of written examination that we have to take for even students coming out of good educational institutions, why do we have to do that? If they have a certain quality of education where basic English, maths and critical thinking is ensured, then the employers can focus much more on identifying capabilities to lead, identifying capabilities to design, identifying capabilities to strategize, but those unfortunately does not happen. A lot of energy is put into bringing their capabilities up to the basic one. So give them that strength through the educational institution that you are running right now, where they don't come in crippled with not even having the basic knowledge. So that's what I'm hoping that the parents pay for, the students expect as well, and me also as an employer one. But prepare them to face the world, which is significantly changing. I can talk about the organization that I'm with right now. Okay, I used to be a director of an NGO, so 3,000 plus employees all across the country, directly talking to the beneficiaries of your arrangement. There are very few people who can do that. Employers face the change over the years. We're delivering differently. Unilever has changed. The competitive market has changed. Banks are changing. How many of us have gone to a traditional bank branch in the last 2, 3, 4 months? Because we're all doing it online, at home, in our convenience. So the whole prospect of it is changing.
And out of 150 students and listeners, I said, how many of you do know about Union Worship, Union Digital Centers? Only 5 raised their hand. Their banking is more or less concentrated in Dilkusha commercial area. So this type of comfort zone created by even, I should not say any new things, but even by our education is that you will get a posh office, you will get this, the objective should be what you can do for the society. Promotion has brought this world down to somewhere. Now we are thinking that we need to change. So I believe the education curriculum can bring change in incorporating liberal arts to the management, like philosophy, finance, history, literature. These are the things should be brought in, because as a complete set of educational learning, these are the things missing in our curriculum, in businesses. We never talk about philosophy, we never talk about literature, we never talk about history. You call the students, how many of them know about the Mughal Empire history, Indian history, Bangladesh history? I do. Very few people know about it. But history makes man wise. Philosophy great. Literature, which. So these are the things that are instructed into a personal life for investigation. So we need to know about more about the phonetic knowledge and know about more the liberal arts, that even in today's world, that they are reading some easily quote, they call. We need the
connection. And if that is not strong in my thinking process, I will never be able to relate to the person who is pulling my insurance. And I will never be able to feel a part of this country. I will always feel like I have been brought up in this country out of coincidence, and I can go and live anywhere in the world. And that creates the root of identity crisis. I think a lot of people who are going abroad and settling, they suffer from this. They are neither Bangladeshis, they're neither Americans, Australians, they just suffer from an identity crisis that carries on to their next generation. So I think this sense of history is not just for our groups. I mean, we are kind of creating a machine that produces people who would go and settle outside. So I mean, particularly high school, if we look at high school, I mean, if we look at the curriculum of high school, I mean, what is it really teaching us about the history and pride of this country? I mean, history is the one thing that connects me.
When Mithun was referring to the whole social aspect of it, we realized that our way of capitalism model is not really working. So when I was studying in business school, the focus maybe was after money at any cost. Now we are talking about triple bottom line and everything, but I think there's a huge shift in terms of how do you look at society and people at the center of everything that we do. The second component is the technology, and which is shifting fundamentally so much that even people who are working in technology, they cannot predict what's going to happen to years down the line. So that's a massive shift at a rate of change which is going to be almost impossible for us to predict. And it's not just technology use, I think it's the use of the AI and how I can solve a small problem using in some form of technology solution which is coming up, where I, being a student, actually can solve and I don't really need big support of the company system. So this is opening up a completely new horizon. Now I think the question to ask is, what are we doing in that space? How are we preparing people in that completely changed context, not just for tomorrow, but ideally looking for 10 to 15 years from now? And when we bring that perspective in, so many things that we do, I don't know, I studied business school, I think 15 years back.
Building, because if they do not understand the country deeply, properly, how will they understand where they stand in society? And I think this is the job of the school teachers, and the university has to create a platform where they love their country, number one. Number two is, I think the concept of self-respect and dignity needs to be imbued in students. I find that even for a little child in our school, and even for students here, it all, you know, dignity needs to be, it needs to be nurtured. And the university is a platform where it can go away or it can be nurtured. And if you do not imbue dignity, whatever they do cannot be sustainable in the long run. So I think that's a very important component of creating a value system. And value system is in everyone, but it needs to be nurtured. So it needs, you have to build the skills besides building other skills of empathy, of compassion, honesty, tolerance. These need to be built also. And the value of this and why it's important for the world in which you live in, that needs to be improved. I find in the organization that I'm in that mid-level management is a challenge. I have people with mid-level management. And people, leadership is a skill, leadership is something which you can train people in a little bit. Some will be great leaders, some will just manage. But mid-level management is really a core component. And I tell my managers, the day I come and I see that you're doing nothing because all the staff is doing all the work, that's when you get your needs to manage. And I think this importance of this needs to be imbued in our children that Bangladeshis, I very likely agree with you, I have great hopes. I have great hopes for the people going from this country, but they need to understand that they are the hopes. And if they are not being, and it's up to the universities to be able to imbue this because they are at such a critical foundation age, that this responsibility is great on you. And as Nibul very rightly said, that you know, there are things that organizations, I think, like ours can share. We're sharing with international universities, why cannot we have more of Bangladeshi students?
We have the history of education more. I taught my son, but most of my son's friend doesn't know about it. Who is the father of the nation, who is there, nobody knows. That has to be, then there will be, I think, something or something. And one point I'd like to add is, can you make arrangements of social working, like voluntary working, maybe in Dhaka Medical Hospitals or Rampur Medical program, you know, they just help the old people or the patients.
I think this is necessary because we did it in our time when I was in St. Francis in 1968. And we had this sort of programs going to Dhaka Medical College, Chittagong Medical College, just maybe cleaning the ward or something like that. So this, I think, will interact, you know, not the Apollo Hospital or this hospital. I think only for maybe 2 days they will go for cleaning up the Dhaka Medical College or Chittagong Medical College. I don't know. And for that, if the parents have to pay for this touring, we are ready to do that. But I think this interaction is very, very important. And as I always said to Omar Bhai, that why I sent my son here, because I always compare that my son was from Sandeep, and I said, this is Sandeep, and that's not Sandeep scholastic. So, you know, this university has a quality of not, they have quality, but not quantity. And that's what I like, that they could have had 20,000 students and make money, and they are not doing that. So this is what, that's why I have to send my son here. And I think the basic thing is socializing with the rulers, you know. So this is what we need. Then our students are...
If the impact we are taking to the university is with the right quality, eventually we'll end up with good quality students into the market. This is one thing. Secondly, I was having a session. I am basically giving certain, since I had certain exposure, in the corporate environment, I didn't get the exposure as I could mention a few other speakers also mentioned. So I think that is enough.
In Khulna, because of the FE program. And sometimes you learn about how they are, but what you really learn is about how lives are different and how you can touch multiple lives. At the end of the day, that's what you do. Thinking about building with this part of the world. What we call internally the next billion users, bringing them online. We talk about bringing the next billion users online from this part of the world, activating them, getting them to do things that they've not done before through access, information. And it's not just for a tech company, it's for any company that you see in the world now. They are focused on India, they're focused on Southeast Asia, they're focused on this part of the world because I believe the rest of the world has already plateaued. And this is where you see the most growth. And so if that information were to be communicated a lot stronger to the SAAS, the universities, folks, we'd be a lot more proud of thinking that, look, the world is building for us. It's about us, about how we can build our brand to adapt and be ready for that. Are we ready for that? And the last thing that I really want to touch upon is what I envision going forward and how we can help. I mean, I can speak for myself, I can speak for my organization, I can speak for the people here on the board.
Philosophy and sociological courses is an appreciation for policy. So, for example, I work in another group, I work in Grammar Forum, we have this huge appreciation for the macro policies that are in place. But why are the policies there? How do they come to be? So, appreciation for big history, local history, all of these are important to truly appreciate our grand macroeconomic stakeholders and regulators, our customers, society at large. And all of this will come into play if only a graduate has a really well-rounded education. Not only for a specific engineering or computer science, it has to be philosophy, it has to be sociology, to develop the different perspectives that a new resource should have for organization to make decisions that are beyond the legacy mentality that certain organizations may have. So that those are the learnings I have. As one of the parents have highlighted, we have a program called Live In-Field Experience, where for 3 months, a student is sent to the field in Bangladesh. There are many locations where they learn to interact with locals, different stakeholders, police, authorities, and this is a very helpful experience if a graduate wants to work for something like EAT, where they have to interact with distribution workforce, with different local authorities and stakeholders. So we need to prioritize and monitor that, so that when we create graduates for the country, they know the rural marketplace quite well and start. So learn how this, the vendor side, software side, how do they handle the business and part of the value chain? It's so important. So my learning curve would have remained much simpler if I had been more adventurous, and have these multiple internships. So I feel that's an improvement here that school of business can have by collaborating with many marketing agencies, for example, Market Access that work for BAT, and many other agencies that can help graduates to learn what the roles of the corporate world. I have seen with my own eyes that not ATOs, but different executives are absorbed into the
business. I really want to thank you very, very much for having done this. Having started, you can't get away. So now, what do we, what are
The textile industry is a big industry, but would you believe that there are very few qualified people? This food industry has come up with people who are not even out of Dhaka. And if you go into the garment industry, you find out that of the 50 officers who are there, not more than 10 have been educated in Dhaka. What does that say? That says there's a great bit of latent potential now. Because these people have not gone into any of this school. If you come into a garment factory, if you look at the emails, you'll be horrified with the level of English. Because they've never gone through it, but that works. I mean, sometimes I get really amazed how it works, but it works. I mean, they're getting the thing done, they're writing emails which are very offensive. You would not even look at it, but that's how they keep doing it. We need to go to the next step. No, we've come here, but that doesn't stop us. This is something we've gathered. If we want to move to the next step, this is not going to happen. So we have to create quality manpower for the entire industry. So, doctor, you are extortions. You don't trust anyone. And in a way, we are not. We have to come and work together. That is something which I think you need to discipline work to come in. And it has to come in from academia. Very important. Academia can bring people together because they remain neutral and they have to have an open mind. And if they don't have, they have to open it up to us. You know, we know that there are certain people who are growing.
From on the Microsoft Red Blue that we've done for others is we offer something called an externship. With internship as it is very structured.
And the one thing that I got out of it was the very strong and very appropriate emphasis on breadth and not on specific skill building. And I think this is who's an anthropologist who wants to join a social enterprise. We can diminish the need who has specific expertise. And I, you know, in a way, I'm wondering whether our good model of getting these young people very focused very early on, which is very much a South Asian and Asian model, is actually doing
and also our dean, Dr. Sarwar, he was down with dengue fever and it's the first time he had come out, so we have to take it easy. Thank you.